didn't plan to go back to Moments with the Master in Kentucky, and so let's just watch this brief video. So that's coming up on our February break. Is Kyle Pittman in here? He's way up, standing in the back, so you really can't see him. He's way up in the back up there, waving. Please speak to Kyle if you have any questions or you'd like to go. You know the saying of many hands make light work, and so we have the opportunity to go and to serve there in Kentucky. Tonight, our youth are going to be heading over to Salem have what's our second The Gathering. This is something that that I wanted to start here in our county. We had our first one back in, I believe, September here, and so tonight we're heading over to Salem, and the bus is going to be leaving the church here around 20 after 5. So please, students, you just had 3 days off of school. Let's get together, have some fellowship and some fun, and get to know other students in our area. And we'll return around 5:30. Tonight also we have our quarterly church conference, and so family, please make sure we are here for that as well. Thank you for once again joining us in worship. Let's just take a moment and ask God's blessing on our time. Father God, we thank you so much for the opportunity to sing your praises, to come together to hear about you. God, may it be all about you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. We want the glory of the Lord to rise in this place. Amen. Amen. If you would you rise? And would you take just a few moments to welcome those around you? Tell them I'm glad to see you in God's house this morning.
Only a God like you.
is the wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Savior. He is the peacemaker. He is the one who brings redemption to us all. Amen. Let's continue to praise his name this morning. What a beautiful name. You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are right. What a beautiful name.
What a wonderful name it is.
Amen. What a powerful name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Would you be seated this morning as we continue to talk about these unifying principles? And this month we've been focusing on our giving and the acts of generosity. Let me ask you this. How many of you have done an act of generosity already? How many of you have turned a card back in and let us know about it? A little bit less. We got to know about it. We want to know if we can reach this 10,000, okay? The first week we started this, we had the unifying principle that was very simple. God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. Can you say that with me? God loves a cheerful giver. Now, say it to your neighbor. God loves a cheerful giver. You don't sound convinced of that quite yet, but all right. But this morning's principle is very simple. It is this. God blesses us so that we can bless others. Say that with me. God blesses us so that we can bless others. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8 says, "And God is able to give you more than you need so that you will always have all you need for yourselves and more than enough for every good cause." And that's not just with our finances. That's with everything. God gives you talent. Use the talent to bless others. God gives you time and resources. Use those to bless others. It is not a very easy, it's not a very complicated thing to do. It just takes a total mindset change to be on the lookout for those times when we can use what God has given us to bless others. I want you to look at this video and see how this one lady blessed others with her gift.
I just remember talking with my grandmother, and she was like, "Your husband's not walking yet, and he's not putting words together. At this point, he should, be putting two words together. He just struggled to communicate." She was trying really hard not to jump to the conclusion of autism. Is he just gonna take a little bit longer to get to this point, or is there something that might really be happening right now? It took about a year or two to kind of figure that out and realize that that really was what was happening with him. And I saw like how hard it was. And I think that that was a big part of it, was like not really knowing what the future held for him and being worried about, so where does he go to school now and how they were gonna make it work. And so I opened up this article, and the school started using an iPad to see how the kids could use it for schooling. And there's all these apps that you can buy that go on the iPad that kids with autism use to communicate. And I was talking to my friend. I was like, "I gotta tell you something. Every time I open my iPad, I've been thinking about my cousin who has autism." And I was like, "I need to give this to him." And I was like, "God, hold me to it, because I'll just keep making excuses for not sending it." And I didn't want to make them feel awkward. His parents not giving it to him, the younger cousin is. But I just knew that, like, I was supposed to give it to him. And so Monday, I'm sending it. So I get to the post office and it's at school. I handed it over and I like paid for the shipping and everything. I was like, "I really feel like this is what I'm supposed to do. And I'm moving beyond something that's easy." Our grandmother, she called me and she just started crying, and she said, "His parents feel so honored that you think of your cousin in that way and want to give that to him."
An iPad. Do you want to see it?
I love it, and I think it's going to improve her life.
Bit of an unknown about how it was received, and today I think it reinforced the fact that, like, he probably wasn't really able to use it, and it was what I was supposed to be doing. that that story had been told, people had really grabbed onto the fact that it wasn't about me giving something, it was about the kids receiving it. And it just caused like this movement of overflowing generosity. And the joy that comes from that, that touches so many people, more than just the person who receives. You know, the joy in just giving away.
I don't know about you, but I'm a bit of a tech person, and that one kind of hit me. I love my iPad. How many of you have an iPhone or iPad or a tablet or anything like that? You realize just how blessed we are in this country? I heard one preacher say, given a testimony, and in the middle of it, he was talking about how blessed we are in the United States, and we don't even realize that. And he took a dollar bill, and he crumpled it up, and he threw it out in the middle of the aisle, and nobody moved for it. And he said, do you realize that 90% of the world doesn't make that in a day? How much would it take for us to start jumping up and fighting over it when it gets to be a $10 bill or $20 bill or $100 bill? We just got to change our focus on things, right? The point is, God may not call you to give away an iPad or an iPhone, but he's going to call you to give away something, and we've got to be ready to give it away. It's not ours. It's all his in the beginning. Amen? Amen. I want to go ahead and dismiss our children. They're going to be heading on down to Children's Church. You guys can follow Sarah and her crew out. And as they continue, go out, and want to invite us to stand. And would you sing this simple chorus that really tells us what we need to be doing?
Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
God, we're
Brother Chuck's going to come. Our ushers are coming. Would you prepare our hearts now to give back to God in tithes and offerings?
Let's pray. Father, as we have been focusing on generosity these past few weeks, Lord, you have constantly reminded us of your generosity toward us. Lord, we know already everything that we have received from your hand. God, you have blessed us beyond measure, and even as we've said today, so that we can be a blessing to others. But God, it goes so much farther than that. Your generosity means that we can be forgiven, that we can have eternal life because you gave the greatest gift of all, your Son. And so, Father, I just pray this morning as we continue to think on and to meditate on your generosity toward us, Father, that we would be moved toward generosity ourselves, not just in our finances, Lord, but in every area of our life, that we would honor you and that you would receive all the glory and the praise and the worship for it, because it all belongs to you. And so, Father, now as we have the opportunity to give our tithes and our offerings, I pray, Lord, that we would be generous and that we would give over and above what we are able. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Acquainted with our sorrow, to trade the debt we owe, your suffering for our freedom, the Lamb of God in my place, your blood poured out my sin. Raised to life, hallelujah, the
Thank you, praise team. God bless you so much. Well, good morning. Glad you're here. How many of you rather be here than home with the flu? All right? Man, we don't want you to get the flu. We want you to stay away from that and pray the Lord take care of you and you won't have that. I want to give you, going to look at the book of Ecclesiastes this morning, chapter 2, and you can find that scripture and follow along as we read that in just a moment. But I want to mention again what Brian had already mentioned about the 10,000 acts of generosity. We encourage you to fill these cards out and to turn them in. We had a goal. We talked about it in the staff meeting, and Brian kind of pitched the idea, and we loved it, that to try to do 10,000 acts of generosity. We could do that, but you have to be participating, and you have to be involved, and we want you to write it down and put it in the offering plate or bring it to the office or put it in a box, but we want you to do this. We're going to all do this, and the Lord will bless us. You know, you can't outgive God. And when we are generous, we just kind of reap the blessings of the Lord. I believe this past year we saw that. We had better budget receipts this past church year than we had since 2008. You know, God is to be praised. And we praise Him for that. And I know the finance team probably said a word about that tonight in our conference to follow our 5 o'clock preaching. But it was a good year, 2017. And you know, when you're giving to missions and you're giving to others and you're giving to causes and you're helping people, you have the Lord's favor and the Lord blesses. You just can't outgive God. And so we encourage you to be faithful in doing that. One other word before we begin this morning. I have spoken to Pastor Barry Saunders several times this past week in Arequipa, Peru, as he was teaching evangelism in the Peruvian International Seminary in Arequipa. And he taught evangelism. They did their practicum on Saturday. They went out in the community. They had 5 people come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So we praise the Lord for that. But I noticed that Barry tried to call me a couple of times last night. I missed his calls, and I called him early this morning. And he lived through an earthquake last night, 6.1. And I talked to him this morning. He was talking with Patty on the phone when the floor began to move and the building began to rock. And he said it's the weirdest thing he's ever been through. And he felt the aftershocks and said he didn't sleep very much last night. Who would have, you know? And I just appreciate him for his faith and his courage to go and to share the gospel, and people have come to know the Lord. And so we want to continue to pray for him. This morning at 10 o'clock, he and Pastor Julio flew to Ayacucho, which is up in the Andes Mountains, and he was going to be teaching 62 pastors there this week. And he's going to be teaching those 62 pastors what he was teaching the 20-plus pastors and lay people in Arequipa this past week. So you pray for him that the Lord would bless and meet his needs. There won't be any more tremors, earthquakes, and he'll be home Thursday. And we want to pray for his safe travel. Pray for Patty and their family, if you would please. I want you to look in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 2, beginning with verse 7. And this is the word of the Lord, and we're talking today. We've been talking about living it up, and we've been talking about generosity and giving and what we do with our wealth and what we do with our money and what we do with the resources that God has blessed us with and how we use those and those kind of things. And today we're looking at Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 7 and following, and it reads this way. It's about Solomon. I bought male and female slaves, had slaves who were born in my house. I had also great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been born before me in Jerusalem. I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. I got singers, both men and women, and many concubines and delight of the sons of man. So I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. And whatever my eyes desire, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. Then I considered all that my hands had done and the toil I had expended in doing it. And behold, all was vanity and striving after wind, and there was nothing to be gained under the sun. Would you pray with me, please? Our Father in heaven, this morning we thank you for your grace that sustains us and enables us and comforts us in the time of trouble. And we're thankful, Lord, that we can be in this place today and to worship you in spirit and in truth. We acknowledge today, Father, that we are so blessed, so blessed. We live in the greatest country in the world, and you bless us with every good and perfect gift. And Father, sometimes it's just that we have become so spoiled with the luxury and the blessing that we have and everything that's at our fingertips that we fail to count our blessings and give thanksgiving and gratitude to you for all that we have. And we think of other people in other parts of the world and even some that live right around us that don't have as much as we have, how you could use us to bless them if only our hearts were open and prepared and willing. Have you been so great and generous to us, Father, in sending your Son to be the Savior of the world? Help us to open our hearts and our hands and allow the blessings that you give to us to flow through us that we might bless others. Today, Lord, as we consider the life of Solomon and his pursuit of life and his pursuit of happiness and his pursuit of joy, we see that he did not find it in luxury. He did not find it in pleasure. He did not find it in physical activity and immorality. It was like chasing the wind. We know, Father, that Jesus Christ came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And life can only be found at the foot of the cross in Jesus. And so today, Father, I pray that every hearer in this place and those that would be watching, Father, you would stir our hearts today. May we search our hearts, and may we know within ourselves that we do have life in Christ Jesus. And if there's someone that's listening or watching that does not know Jesus Christ, today the Holy Spirit would bring conviction. They'd call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. But Father, speak to our hearts in these moments and help us to be people of generosity, people who give as you give, without grudging, but cheerfully and willingly. Shield me behind the cross, Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Monopoly. How many ever played Monopoly? Well, if you hadn't played Monopoly, you hadn't been around. You're on another planet. All right? Monopoly. We've all played Monopoly. The subject today is Monopoly, pursuing more. Solomon was a man that was always pursuing more. I came across a phrase that said, the vacuum in the heart is not money-shaped, but God-shaped. I want you to turn to your neighbor and repeat this to him. Now, you're both talking at the same time, so I don't know who's listening. But anyway, speak it to your neighbor. The vacuum in the heart is not money-shaped, but God-shaped. Okay, the vacuum in your heart is not, it's not money-shaped, it's God-shaped. And the only thing that can fill the void in your heart is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. There was a guy named Charles B. Darrow of Germantown, Pennsylvania. In his creative genius, he created the board game we know as Monopoly. He brainstormed this game in this country during the Great Depression. Now, the Great Depression started in 1929. Monopoly came on the scene in 1934. And so they're already going through depression, but this guy named Charles Darrow began to think about Monopoly, and he created this game called Monopoly. And he took it to Parker Brothers, and he said, here's a game. Would you produce this? Would you buy this and produce this? And Parker Brothers rejected the game because it had 52 design errors. They wouldn't touch it. Darrow, refusing to be denied because he said this game is good and this game can make it and everybody in this country needs to start feeling good about some things, and so I'm not going to give up. So with the help of a friend that knew how to print, he produced 5,000 handmade sets and he sold them to to a Philadelphia department store where it became an overnight sensation. In 1935, Parker Brothers came back to Dara. Reckon why? And they said, we want to buy the rights to this game. It is estimated that 500 million people have played Monopoly. Now, you know the game of Monopoly. Let's have a little trivia. Well, I'm not going to ask you questions, just listen. There are more than 200 million games that have been sold. Think about that. More than 200 million games of Monopoly have been sold. More than 5 billion little green houses have been produced. There was a game with solid gold houses and pure silver hotels that once sold for $25,000. I'll ask you this question, and I don't hear, so you just shout out what you think it is. Does anybody know the longest game in history of Monopoly, how long it lasted? How long do you think the longest game lasted?
7 minutes.
How many?
7 minutes.
Oh, you're way off. Okay. Anybody else? Just take a guess. Longest game. How many?
30.
No. 75. The longest game played lasted 75 days. Those people probably didn't work. I don't know. But anyway, 75 days. Now, you really want to get crazy? A game played underwater lasted 45 days. Wow. Now, you know the little green money in the box? The ones, fives. The total amount of Monopoly money in a box, do you want to guess? What's the total? Ah, come on. What do you think the total is? Let me tell you what the total is. The total of the money in a Monopoly box is $15,140. Now, what's really kind of interesting about this game that Dara created is this game is about pursuing more, became a hit in the midst of the Great Depression. The Great Depression started in 1929. In 1934, Dara's created Monopoly. Parker Brothers got it in 1935, and people are buying the game. He was simply saying to a community in a world that was battling depression, if you can't be rich, you can be rich by pretending you're rich as you play a board game. And people were buying Monopoly. Now, have you ever thought about wealth and power and money might be the answer to all of life's problems? There are people in this world that think money and power and wealth are the solution to everything in this world. Solomon was a person who thought, you know, I got it. And if I got it, I can attain it and I can accumulate it. And he did accumulate so much. He owned so many things. And yet Solomon realized that as he pursued those things in his heart, those things that he thought would bring pleasure and happiness and joy, he was so disillusioned because they did not bring the joy and gladness that he thought it would be. This idea, a little bit of money creates a longing for more. Do you know that? A little bit of money creates a longing for more. Now, we are multi-generational, and we got every age group here. But when Deborah and I were married and went to Southwestern Seminary in 1976, we lived on $65 a week. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking what I used to think when I was a student or adolescent at church. Preacher is old, ain't he? Listen. And you know what we've understand? And we talk about it. Deborah and I talk about it. We've always managed to live on what we make. But then when you get a little more, you start wanting a little more and desiring a little more and wanting to accumulate a little more. And a little bit of money creates a longing for more. When John D. Rockefeller was the world's wealthiest man, he was asked, how much is enough? Now imagine, John D. Rockefeller was asked the question, how much is enough? And Rockefeller responded, just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. Now, you know what you call that? when we say just a little bit more, it is the escalation expectation. Just a little bit more. And when you get a little bit more, what do you want? Just a little bit more. And when you get just a little bit more, what do you want? Just a little bit more. And satisfaction in life does not come by the accumulation of wealth and possessions and fortune and fame. And the book of Ecclesiastes is about the life of Solomon and his sorrowful search to find meaning and purpose in life. And he came to the final realization that meaning can only be found in God alone. So today, if you're looking for life, listen to what Jesus says in John 10:10. I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. You will not find life in wealth and riches and fortune and fame. You will not find life. To put it in monopoly terms about Solomon, Solomon owned all the property, all the utilities, all the railroads, all the hotels. Everything was spilling off the board. His stacks of money were so high that his opponent couldn't even see what he had. He had everything. He owned everything. And the irony of Solomon's state, in spite of all of his wealth, in spite of all of his women, in spite of all of his power, in spite of everything that he had a dissatisfied heart and soul. If you would take this passage of Scripture and read it in the Message, it would give you a little contemporary insight into Solomon. The French philosopher, Pascal, noted in the 17th century that the vacuum in the heart, in Solomon's heart, in your heart, in my heart, isn't money-shaped. It's God-shaped. And when Solomon tried to fill that void with money and wealth and sex and fortune and fame and everything except God, he grew more and more dissatisfied with life. You think about all those people that had wealth and money and fortune and fame that came to life and said, what is life? Life is nothing. And they'd end their lives sadly by some means or measure, because life was not found in stuff. When you read the Scripture, Solomon tried everything. He had everything. He tried finding fulfillment, and it was all a bust in all that he had. He tried toys. Now, he had toys. He had the latest toys, the latest gadgets and gizmos and everything else. Whatever Solomon wanted, he could buy. He had more money to shake a stick at. If I want it, I'll get it. If I want it, I'll have it. If I want it, there it is. Get it for me. He could buy it. Money was no object. He tried to fulfill it with music. And it wasn't just having a CD player. It wasn't just having a DVD player. He bought the band. He brought the band in. He had the singers. He had the musicians. He had it all. Didn't bring him happiness. He had it all. Laughter. He didn't just go to the comedy club. He brought the comedians in, paid for them. They told the jokes and told the stories, and he'd laugh and he'd laugh and he'd laugh. But the laughter didn't bring any comfort, and the laughter didn't bring any peace, and the laughter did not help him find any fulfillment. Not at all. And talking about sex, 700 wives and 300 concubines. You think about that. The concubines were for his sexual pleasure. Solomon said, you know, I got all these women. Well, that was part of his problem, all these women. Hard enough to keep one happy, isn't it? And I know it comes back the other way, ladies, all right? But it did not bring fulfillment. It did not bring joy. It did not bring gladness. And he bought everything money could buy, and Solomon denied himself nothing. That's what we read in the Scripture. He said, I did not deny myself of anything. Anything and everything I wanted, I took, I grabbed, I wanted it. And Solomon played out every fantasy in real life, and nothing brought him joy, peace, hope, or comfort. So I want to ask you a loaded question. I want you to answer out loud. I want you to think about it. When will you be happy? What will it take to make you happy? So here's the question. I will be happy when. And what are you going to put in the blank? Now, first of all, you and I need to understand, in this culture in which we live, it's driven by the accumulation of stuff and feel good and all that kind of stuff. And we need to understand that God's purpose and plan for our life is not for us to be happy, but be holy. But we understand we have an inner joy and happiness by a personal relationship, an interpersonal relationship with Jesus Christ. But if you filled in the blank, I will be happy when, what do you put there? And if you put anything in that blank except the name of Jesus Christ, then it's futile. You will be happy when your life is sold out and committed to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and you've crucified the flesh, and you're no longer living for yourself, but the life you live in the flesh, you live by the faith of the Son of God who loved you and gave himself for you. And you die to your desires and you die to your wants. You humble yourself in the sight of God and you live for him. The cry of this generation is, do not repress your desire, because that's dangerous and it leads to depression, maybe even suicide. No matter what your desire is, whether it's to be gender identity or sexual orientation or pleasures or dreams, don't repress yourself. That's the message of our culture. And Solomon would say to that, don't kid yourselves. Living for what feels good is dangerous. It will not bring you joy. It will not bring you satisfaction. And the little bit of joy and pleasure you get is just for a brief moment. And the consequences are serious. What's going to bring you happiness? What's going to bring you joy? So here's a question I put before us today. What is the purpose of wealth? What's the purpose of money? Brian gave a great word this morning about throwing a dollar bill out in the crowd and nobody moved at all. What's a dollar? It might not seem like much. But in other parts of the world, it's more than folks get in a day, a week, a month, maybe a year. What's the purpose of wealth? Now, we must acknowledge that it's God that gives us the power to get wealth. It says this in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you power to get wealth, that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your fathers, for this is the day. God gives us the power to get wealth. God enables us through our strength, our health, our opportunities, our education, our skills, our talents to secure wealth. And God gives us wealth. He gives us the ability to have wealth. And here's what we need to understand. Money's not bad. Money is not evil. It is okay to have money. Money is amoral. Money is not evil. The Bible is very clear. Money is not evil. But rather, the Bible says very plainly, the love of money, it is the love of money that is the root of all evil. Listen to what it says in 1 Timothy 6:10. For the love of money is the root of all sorts of evil. And some by longing for it have wandered from the faith. Now wait, time out. Hear what he said? He says, the love of money is not the root of all sorts. The love of money is a root of all sorts of evil. And some by loving it and longing for it have wandered away from the faith. Have you allowed your pursuit for stuff and wealth and riches and fortune and fame and comfort to cause you to drift away from your devotion and commitment to Jesus Christ? Another church, another place, another time. We had a deacon. He was very active, always there, always there, always there, always there, always there. Man, he was always doing, always serving, always. He's a great guy. And the Lord had blessed him in his business, and his business was growing. And I noticed that he stopped coming on Wednesday night. And then I noticed that he missed Sunday morning. Then he missed the next Sunday morning. He missed the next Sunday morning. And I asked his wife, called her name, and said, what's going on with him? She says, Brother Al, I'm kind of concerned about him because the Lord's blessing his business, and now he just wants to work, 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 and enlarge the tent, enlarge the tent, enlarge the tent. He began to drift. It began to affect his relationship with his spouse. It began to affect, certainly, his relationship with God. He had a massive stroke. Not able to work. Not able to go. His wife said to me, you know, he knows he got away from God pursuing wealth, fortune. He knows he's wrong. He's asked God to forgive him. I want to ask you a question. It happened to any of us. Are you pursuing after the stuff of this world more than you are pursuing a likeness of Christ and the holiness of God? It says the love of money is the root of all evil, and some longing for it have wandered from the faith. They've wandered away. They've allowed money to become their God, and it's their idol, and they're committing idolatry, and they've wandered away from God. They've wandered from the faith, and listen, and pierced themselves with many griefs. That's what happened to that brother. Pierced himself with many griefs because he let money come between him and God. We can't purchase with money anything that will satisfy the longing need of the inner being. You hear that? We can't buy with money anything that would meet the longing of an inner need. Do you know what I hear and I see? Particularly years ago when the mall was real popular. Now people buy online probably as much as they go to the mall or anything like that. But people say, I feel bad. I think I'm going to the mall. Why? Got to buy something. As though buying something would make them feel better. Well, it does for a while, and then they get the credit card bill, they got to pay for it. Buying something does not satisfy the inner longings of the heart and the soul, and having stuff does not satisfy the inner longings of the heart. And we can use money and wealth to help others have the basic needs in life and do unto others as we'd have them to do unto us, and do to others as Christ Jesus would do and as he did as he walked the face of the earth. And we can be generous and use the blessings that God has given us to help others, or we can hoard it and live for it, and we can become cynical and miss out on life. God has saved us and brought us into himself that his favor and his blessing could flow through us to others. And it doesn't matter how small or how big, as long as our lives and our heart are an open channel through which the love of God and the grace of God could flow, we can use the blessings and the resources that God gives us, not only for our own comfort, and there's nothing wrong with leisure and comfort. Here's the thing, it's when that becomes our God. It's when that has us and it begins to control us and the way we live and the way we think, that's when it's wrong. But as long as we keep it in perspective and we understand it all comes from God, and so it just passes from God to us through our hand to help others and love others and cater for others. It's great. You see, our pursuit as Christ followers should be to be more like Christ. Our pursuit as Christ followers should be dedicated to Jesus Christ and using our resources for the glory of God, for the advancement of the kingdom, to help someone less fortunate than ourselves. This idea of generosity that we're doing, here's what we believe. We believe that when we love others and help others and use our resources to bless others, God pours out his blessings in such a way that we can't even begin to express or imagine what it would be. And we don't do it for that reason. But there's a principle here. When you open your hands to help others, your hands are open to receive from God. Little things. Don't live for money. If you're blessed, and we all are, find some way you can help somebody else. Well, I hadn't put my generosity this past week on a card, so I'll verbalize it and I'll write it down. In January of last year, 2017, Barry and I went to Arequipa, Peru, and our translator was Danny, and we were sitting at a table having lunch, and he looked at my arm He said, you have on an Apple watch. I thought, please don't ask me for my watch. He said, I love that band you have on your watch. Will you let me have it? I said, it's the only one I got. How am I going to keep my watch on my wrist if I give you my band? He says, well, you know, I'm in Peru. I have a hard time getting those bands for watches. And he had an Apple watch, and he had a band on. He says, but I really like that band. Well, that actually was my favorite band, by the way. The only one I had. And he said, would you let me have that band? I said, you know, Danny, God's going to take care of you. I'm going to make sure you get a band, but I can't give you this band here. I sat in my office, and I was thinking about all this generosity things that we were talking about. I knew Barry's about to go to Peru. And I took my little tool, and I took the band off of that watch. And I put a little Apple box that I got them. Now, I've got several bands now. That's my favorite. I put that band in a box. Then I had another band. It was a sports band that I'd only worn once. And I put that in the box and put a tool in there. And I said, Barry, I want you to take this and give it to Danny. And Barry and Danny are sitting at a table. And Barry says, Pastor Al wants me to give you this. And he saw what it was. And he said, Barry said, he went nuts. Said he broke into the box. And he took the band off his watch and put that black band that I had on my watch in January 2017. He said, this is the one I wanted from Brother Al all the time. Barry said, you would believe how ecstatic and excited and enthused he was that even though you wore that band for a year, it was like new to him. Wow. And I started thinking, I got a black one, I got a blue one, I got a white one. And he gets one. He goes nuts. When you speak about people around us that we can help in small, insignificant ways to make a difference in their lives. Let's not hoard and accumulate for ourselves. Let's open our hands and allow the blessings of God to flow through them. I want you to do something this morning. I want you to pray this prayer. Lord God, as we begin a new week, help my eyes to be open. And help my heart to be sensitive that when I see a need and I'm able to meet the need, you'd help me respond accordingly. Lord Jesus, open my eyes. Make my heart sensitive that this week, when I'm aware of a need I'm able to meet, I'll be quick to do it. And as we've done it unto the least of these, we've done it unto Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, our desire as a staff and as leaders is that this church year might be the greatest church year in the life of Bethany Baptist Church, because we will go way beyond the second mile in this thing of generosity. That we'd give of ourselves. We'd pray. We'd be prepared. We'd be sensitive. And we'd be willing help others. And Father, I pray today if there's someone sitting here and something that was spoken today, the Holy Spirit took that and just zapped the heart because they know they're living for stuff and they're living for the accumulation of stuff and they're trying to find life and they think life can be found in a new car or a new house or some toy. But life isn't found there. Life is found at the foot of the cross. So if there's someone here today that needs Jesus, help us to respond accordingly. all across this auditorium, Father. May you be preparing our hearts today and this year to sow generosity through our community, our families, wherever we are, to such a magnitude that the world will take note that Jesus Christ is alive at Bethany. Jesus Christ is alive in the hearts of those people that serve there and go there. Jesus lives. Help us, Lord, to be faithful. As you've been faithful to us, we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand and as we sing, you be obedient to the Lord this morning.
Christ is enough. I have decided.